Welcome. We're here with Solomon Davis. He is the Assistant Director of the Convention Center.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, you're very welcome. Thanks for asking.
So we're here to talk about all things sustainable in Fairfield.
That's a big word.
Yeah. So tell me a little bit about yourself and your position at the Convention Center.
A little bit about myself. Well, for the last couple of decades, I've been in Seattle. The first decade, I was a professional actor full-time, working for a couple of companies, but one that brought me out there initially was a company called Taproot Theater. And then after sort of transitioning out of full-time acting, I went into teaching at a wonderful school called the Northwest School. And I was a theater teacher and part-time actor for the second decade of my time. And then something happened in the world that made both of those things very difficult to be sustainable for myself. And so I looked for employment elsewhere, and I wanted to look at my roots. And I spent my childhood in a town called Clinton, Iowa, just along the Mississippi, a couple of hours away from here. And so I began a search looking to find my way sort of back home.
And when you first found Fairfield, what kinds of things did you see about it that you liked?
Well, let's see. My wife introduced me to the Gilmore Girls, and so I had been spending a lot of time in that little town. And so I think my first impression was, oh, this looks like the Gilmore Girls, which was a fine thing. So the cute square and the small town feel was the first impression. And then arriving at the center, I think, was the second thing that I really took in. And just an impressive facility. And yeah.
And that facility was fundraised by the community.
Yes.
It was a community fundraised kind of project. And mm-hmm. Fairfield's pretty famous for that.
Yeah.
My position is a fundraised position as well.
Nice. Yeah, so, it was about a decade, I think, of fundraising. They started it in 1997, and it opened its doors in 2007.
Wow. Well, do you know what their first event was?
I don't.
That would be a cool thing to look at.
Probably like a community theater play, I would guess. But.
And so, as the assistant director, what are your duties there?
Great question. It's still sort of being evolved. We're sort of creating the plane and fixing it while it's flying. But one of my main responsibilities is trying to get a healthy, robust, and sustainable cinema inside the building. So the Sondheim, as many folks know, is it's known for live performances. And we have done some movie events like the Fairfield History Series. And we've just started this summer doing movies of the month. But coming November, we're hoping to do a lot more longer runs of movies off the break or theatrical releases. So anytime that there's not a live event, there will often be a movie playing in the Sondheim.
So we can count on something happening every weekend?
Every day that we don't have a live performance.
Every day of the week?
Yeah.
And so are there matinees during the weekdays, or is it evening shows?
I don't know if that's going to work right away financially, but certainly during school breaks, we can do matinees. But I'm also going to be listening to the community, and if people will turn out for matinees midweek, then we'll do it.
Great. Yeah. Great. So when you're saying, I don't really know a lot about movies, so you can show what's showing in like Ottumwa, for example, at the same time? Or is it more like a dollar theater type, second run type?
This is a great question. These are questions that I had when I moved here. So the term is off the break. So I think what that means is the studio will release a movie like, let's just pick a big one recently, which was Top Gun. That one happened to be very popular, so they made their theatrical run longer, but a lot of them are getting smaller and smaller windows into the movie theater. So we would get something after it leaves Atumwa. Atumwa would get it kind of in that prime zone, and then we'd get it in like the secondary prime zone. So it'd be right before it goes into the streaming services type of a thing. So, and then we will also be showing Second Run, which is what we've been doing, which are movies that are kind of off the shelf at studios, things that have already had a theatrical run, but are maybe worthy of the silver screen in a community.
So you recently, I know you did the Lord of the Rings series.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
How was that well attended?
It was attended by very intense fans, but I couldn't say that it was super well attended.
All right. Well, people have to get used to it.
Exactly.
Used to the fact that there's going to be movies there.
Right. And it has been difficult to do one day. You know, a one-day event is, I don't think people are used to looking for movies on one day or putting a movie on their calendar. They're more likely, I think, to say, hey, what do you want to do tonight at random? Let's see what movies are playing. It sort of works in the opposite direction, which is why I'm hoping that when we start populating our calendar with movies that we'll get some more turnout.
So will you know in advance if you're going to do like second run movies, when they'll be available?
Movies off the break, yes. Yes, I'll hopefully know a month or so in advance. There are some marketing parameters from the studios, so if a time was showing something, I can't like do a radio ad or put it in the newspaper that we're going to be doing the same thing.
Oh.
You know, we got to be nice to, we got to play nice. So I'll do my best to get the word out, though.
Well, I was just assuming there's probably a lot of rules about
There's a lot of rules, a lot of large contracts that I had to read through.
Well, that's a lot of fun. And so that's really exciting, though. Is there going to be concessions?
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, wow. Popcorn?
Yeah, popcorn. I'm trying to keep everything at $6, so it's going to be 666. Well, it's not the nicest thing to say, but it's going to be $6 movie tickets. I never thought about that until right now.
Wow!
But we're going to keep everything at $6: popcorn, beer, and wine. I think I talked.
Oh wow! All
them
the whole
into
thing.
Wine.
Wow!
And, yeah, just to kind of keep it something that you can kind of keep in mind. You know, you're going out to the cinema, that everything's going to be $6.
Right. Will there be dinner available at night, or just have the lunch there still with the, what's that restaurant there?
Addis, the Ethiopian restaurant. Yeah, it's open from like 11 to 2:30 every day.
Yeah. But there's no spot there in that kitchen for another?
Not for the evenings, not right now, no.
Oh, well, maybe that can develop.
Yeah, I'm hoping that when we have more consistent movies playing that we can create some community partnerships. I'm just trying to avoid the word partnerships. I heard that's a bad word to use in this town because it seems sneaky. But no, some connections with the restaurants, you know, something like you can buy a ticket when you buy dinner at a discount, perhaps.
That's a good idea.
Or letting them know what our schedule is in advance so they can promote it as well. And I don't know.
Yeah, dinner and a movie.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Be creative with the connections in the cuisine.
I like that. Mm. Yeah. Well, I like that you brought up the word partnership, because we've been talking a little bit beforehand about defining words.
Yes.
And, you know, it's very interesting. A lot of words can be taken and basically by advertisers, for example, and they adopt them, and then they change the meaning of the word. So, like the word partnership may not sound really great to some people, but they tend to basically be taken out of their own context and then reapplied in another way. And so we talk a lot about sustainability, and you were saying that you thought that sustainability was just about energy.
Well, I assumed that's what your definition was. That's what a lot of people's definition is, or a lot of people's assumption is.
Right.
But yeah, I was coming in here to talk about my definition of stability, which it turns out is the same as yours,
which is
sustaining a community, sustaining yourself, sustaining the environment that is around you, whether it's the room that we're in and the equipment they're in, or the building, et cetera, and then it expands out there. But
right.
I think of sustaining in a small way and then continuing to grow the more capacity that you have as an individual.
Right. It's kind of, and looking for opportunities to partner or to collaborate and to build.
Collaborate. That's the word. I think that's the one I'm going to use. Yeah.
right. Because we're, you know, as we all grow, I mean, it's like we all want to basically flourish and thrive. And we're moving out of, I think, a long period of atomization or even, you know, I do my work and you do your work and, you know, just leave me be and I got my stuff. But what we're starting to understand, especially after this whole pandemic experience, is that we miss community when we do that. Mm-hmm. We let things fall apart easier when we do that. Mm-hmm. And to be sustainable and resilient, we have to come together as a community and help each other.
100%.
And if that's an attitude of thriving as well, right? And abundance. Because in abundance, there's enough for everybody. So why not collaborate? In an atmosphere of scarcity, it's an idea of like, well, there's only enough for me.
Yeah.
And so I better keep it all to myself or I'll run out.
Yeah. And it does beg the question, where did that narrative come from? And who's wielding it and why? And I don't want to point fingers, but I am looking for ways to combat that or push back against this default narrative that there is scarcity, that there are the bad guys and the good guys, that there are abstractions, and that even though you're a person, the other people are abstractions of people. You know what I mean? I think that whole crap narrative needs to be pushed back against.
The false dichotomy, right? Or even the fallacy of you know, either or.
Yeah. I used to always say there's no either or, there's both and more.
Oh, I love that. Yeah. There's no either or, there's both and more. That's really good. I mean, you're really thinking along the same lines that I'm thinking about, is that a lot of the solutions that we are looking for in a new paradigm are going to come outside of the current paradigm in the current way that we've been accustomed to creating solutions. And I do think it's much more collaborative and much more local. And I don't know if it wasn't so much in my lifetime, but like maybe in my parents' lifetime more. There was a lot of live bands, a lot of local music. And I think even as I grew up, the bandstands were occupied by senior citizens. And they were all playing music beautifully, and people were dancing. And then, you know, we don't see that as much anymore. And it's been taken over by stars in the limelight and famous people and, you know, either big or go home. Well, you know, and we have these star shows on television. I'm not even going to name one of them, where people have to compete and be humiliated. And I think that art is much more of a sharing of the heart with others, and being collaborative is a more natural form for it. Especially since everybody is so individual in their interpretation of anything. I remember when my kids were little, I had a teacher, and she would put a Monet paper painting up, and she would show them how to paint it. And so she was copying Monet, and the kids were copying Monet and her, and they all had a different picture or painting at the end, and they put them all on the board on the wall. It was so beautiful because it was all the same thing, but from so many different perspectives that it was just lovely. And I think, and when all of those are shared and put together, that's when we really have a sustainable community.
Key word there is all.
And you were telling me about your school and about the environment department.
Yeah, I think that's maybe where the, when I was thinking about sustainability and the environment, I was thinking about at the school I was at, the students were basically the custodial staff. They would stop for 15 minutes a day and everyone would clean. Everyone in the building would stop and have a cleaning duty of some sort, whether it's taking out the trash, mopping, sweeping, cleaning the windows, etc. And the seniors, so it was a K through 12 school, and the seniors were the leaders of these groups. So the seniors took the lead on everything.
That's really, really great. I was in the Peace Corps for a while, and work in the society where I was living was communal. We all did it together. Mm. You know, there's like you'll go to your kitchen and slice potatoes, and you go to your kitchen and slice potatoes. Everybody was doing it together, and mm-hmm. it was fun.
Yeah, I think that is something that we could all use a little bit more of. Not only having a piece of the pie, making the pie. I don't know what metaphor I'm going for here, but knowing sort of what your purpose is, and that's a big word right now too. Purpose and meaning. I feel like we're in
value.
In value, yeah. We were talking about young people and retaining our young people and attracting young people. Mm-hmm. And I think purpose is a big word and meaning. In fact, I was talking to Lindsay, the executive director at the convention center, mm-hmm. and I said, hey, I'm going to talk with Rachel. We're going to talk a little bit about attracting young people. What's the first thing that comes to your mind? And she said, purpose. And I completely agree that there's a severe lack of meaning for the kids that are graduating high school right now. And I think it's something we ought to really take some serious look at.
That is a really good point, because we're coming out of, I would call, like the Walmartization of the world. Mm. Is that it has to be cheaper, faster, all from centralized, and uniform. Mm. And the world is not really uniform. And actually, one of the things that Walmartization has also done, I think, is the idea that people and employees can be interchangeable. Mm. And when they first came up with this in business, it was like an efficiency thing. So you have a certain position, and then somebody can stay in that position, and then if they leave, then someone else can take their place. Mm. But I think that was abused to the point. And I was talking to somebody recently about how they can't really get people to stay in certain jobs that are difficult. And part of it is, I think the children or workforce, the young workforce today, has grown up seeing their parents kind of abused in the workforce.
Hmm.
I saw my dad abused. I mean, he was with JCPenney for, 24 and a half years. At 25 years, he was going to get, his full salary and pension. But they found some funny reason to get rid of him.
Hmm.
And as his kid, that really affected me. So when we think about moving on and growing up and entering the adult world, what is our purpose? Is it to just work for somebody and make money so we can buy things? Hmm. Or is it to join a community? And if it is to join a community, which I think we all kind of long for in our hearts, what does that look like?
Yeah, for sure. For
because
sure.
It's been so detached from each other,
mm-hmm.
right? The local square that's where it's always going to be a dance on every Friday night, for example.
Mm-hmm.
You know, those are things that we can start to count on if we don't have to book somebody famous or we have to come up with money to pay for this and that, and we could have a much more of a local entertainment. And mm-hmm. we have this beautiful complex at the convention center. We don't even have to go to the square. We can go to the convention center.
Sure.
And so is the conventioner looking to book more local artists?
Looking to book more local artists.
More local entertainment type things?
I don't know that we currently have a campaign that we are moving strong in that direction right now, but it's definitely something to perhaps look at. Is it something that you're recommending?
Well, I guess based on our little conversation about being more local, more sustainable, engaging locally.
Creating more opportunities for young people to connect to the community. Yeah, mm-hmm. giving them more opportunities. Yeah, I know soon, we are at the end of our season, we have this wonderful group called Naturally 7 coming in, which is this amazing a cappella group. Mm. And they are going to collaborate with the high school choir. And I'm excited about this because it'll bring in the choir into our center and spotlight them and highlight and remind the young folks and their families that the center is here for them, and they'll get a chance to perform on our stage. And I think we could benefit from making more opportunities like that
exist.
Yeah. Another thing that popped into my head in terms of fractioning, or that idea of the big act or the big city, is reminds me of me leaving for college, and college in general being something that we've had a major trade-off that I think we're discovering right now. And the trade-off is we somehow told all of our young people that the only cool, viable option is to leave your hometown, go off to a big fancy college, and that was success. Well, here we are with these depleted, beautiful small towns with not a lot of talent. You know, I mean, maybe not necessarily
or
Fairfield.
Brain drained, or whatever.
Yeah,
you want
we've
call
sort
it,
of huh? drained our small towns because we told our young kids that it wasn't cool and it wasn't success. And I think we need to.
Well, our parents told themselves that they weren't successful if their kids came back.
Exactly.
Like in my generation, yeah. I was like, "Don't you think you're coming back here?" Okay.
Right. Again, the personal sustainability, or and this idea of both and more. But somehow that got out there, and it certainly got into my community. And I know a lot of us that are now kind of in our getting to middle age are rethinking that, and then returning back to our hometowns to pick up the pieces, to reconnect in a lot of ways. And so anyway, I think college was a big part of that. We made college affordable by making loans really accessible, but then we lost a lot of our kids and they're in debt, right? So we just created a lot of other problems. It wasn't 100% bad, but I think it's almost net negative to this at this point in time. So we've got to rethink college, and I think my instinct is we need to get rid of college. Maybe not you, MIU, maybe not you, Indian Hills, uh-huh. You know, I mean, but get rid of the overall narrative
or
that you have to leave.
The idea that college is some kind of a coming of age.
Right, right.
And that you must go to that to become an adult.
If you love to read a lot, if you love to write a lot, and you want to think about the things that you read and that you wrote a lot, then go to college. If those things don't appeal to you like right away, like it's a big deal, I would say find something else to do with your time and energy. And I think if there's industries that are looking for workers, they need to create, I want to use the word pipeline, to our high schools and our community college, mm-hmm. and make it easy for kids to see that there is a way forward with a job that has meaning and purpose, mm-hmm. and cut college kind of out of the equation unless it's necessary, and maybe bolster and invest in some trade schools.
And there are a lot of very sustainable businesses in Fairfield, and that might be a really good suggestion for them to communicate that this is not just a place to work in the summer or between, when you're home visiting for the holidays. This is actually a career. You can start, and we can show you how you can move up and create certainty in an uncertain time. And I was talking to a couple different sustainability committees in town, and that's one of the things we were talking about, is how do you communicate to students that this is a certainty job. We want you for the long haul. Mm-hmm. We don't want, you know, just you coming in and changing you out, you know. Mm-hmm. And I think that's the thing. When value is examined, right? So it used to be, oh, well, you don't go to shop. You know, if you're a mechanic, you got to go to college. You know, and now it's like we need people in the trades. And I was telling you earlier that both my sons are in the trades, and I did get a lot of pressure from my peers. Where are your kids going to college? Mm-hmm. Well, they're not. Well, oh my gosh, what are they going to do? Well, they're going to make a lot more money than your kids getting their bachelor's degrees, because it won't come out with debt.
Right, and I know a lot of people my generation and younger have a lot of interest in creating their own businesses. You don't need to go to college to create a business. Like I said, if you want to read and write and think a lot, then go to college. But if you want to start a business or learn a trade, yeah, there's other ways, and we need to highlight what those ways are. And if they aren't, then we need to build them. And if they're there, we need to give them our attention and our love.
And we have a trades desert right now, they call it, because so many, and also with farmers. Farmers are retiring.
There you go, right
all
there.
The people in the trades are retiring, and there's not a lot of people behind them to come up and take over.
I think we solved the world's problems.
We totally did. I think we definitely did. I wonder, what do you think would be the best approach to, like, get the schools and the businesses together to have, like, a meeting or?
Well, I think we definitely should bring in some of our talented high school thinkers to see kind of what they're thinking about, what they're scared about, and address that. Talk to our industry leaders and see what their concerns are.
Maybe a PTA presentation or something.
Yeah, that'd be great.
To have.
Yeah, just figure out what's missing in terms of a path or a pipeline from school to a purpose-filled career path.
Yeah, I'm going to have some different businesses in here to talk about different things that they're doing in sustainability. And like you said, one of the things that they are doing is solar panels. But it's more than just solar panels, because they want to keep, you know, their workforce happy and vibrant and young. So bringing more people into Fairfield that are young and younger families is the way to basically sustain this community, because and we have an advantage in Fairfield of being very unique and very creative and very collaborative. And there's a lot of community solutions, and there's a lot of people who joined the movement and came to Maharishi University and really didn't find any kind of infrastructure here that they could use. So they had to create everything themselves. And we're going to be talking to Jennifer Hamilton too today, and she's talking about how she modeled her whole elder care program off of kind of the network that had created around young families and children and having babies and helping each other out with meals and things like that. And so it's just an extension of those things, and that's the beautiful thing about a community-centered project, is that the community, this community in particular, is really good at it. And how do we basically engage the younger generation in that same spirit? They had this camaraderie because they were all kind of coming for the same purpose. And so how do we basically open up that network of people to include younger people and people graduating from high school who want to join in what's going on here?
That just reminded me of something that I know, and again, I'm new, so if anybody from MIU watches this, I'm so sorry, because I do know of great things that MIU is doing, like a certain pipeline with their tech workers. I know very little bit about this, but I know it's something similar to what I just mentioned. So like they have like a fairly low tuition, they get the training, and then they get set up with a job and then pay for their tuition once they get a well-paying job. I think that's a great model. I don't know if any of their other programs have a similar model, but we're working with the Cinematic Arts and New Media at the center. We're screening some of their student projects in June at the end of their each year. And I think that partnership can be strengthened, and we are working on getting grants for those filmmakers to, we call them launchpad grants, to send them off to festivals. And some of those students went through that and put their films out in the festivals that might not have otherwise without the grants that the center provided. And so again, I'm just thinking of, that's just one way that the center is trying to engage on this idea of collaboration and pipeline and creating paths with purpose.
That's really an excellent point to kind of end on. And do you have anything else that you wanted to add?
No, I appreciate this conversation a lot.
Well, great. Well, thank you for coming and talking about Sustainable Fairfield.